thank you, Mr. Harsh, for taking your time for us today. We'll probably start by asking you, what do you think are your views on the Indian IT sector?
So there is a short-term view and there is a long-term view. So let me start with the long-term view. I think long-term view is still very, very positive. And when I talk of Indian IT, I would talk of domestic IT as opposed to IT service providers who sell services overseas, because much is written about it and many people track it. But very few know that now domestic IT itself is to the tune of $25 to $30 billion. It's a fairly large market. But by any other dimension in terms of total IT penetration, whether it's devices penetration per 1,000 people in the country or spend by GDP, ratio of IT spend by GDP or ratio of IT spend by turnover of various different sectors, it's still substantially lower than what some other developing countries spend, whether Brazil or China or whether United States. For example, China is almost 7 or 8 times bigger IT market as compared to India for a population that's just 20% more. So for us, 25 billion is, I would say, Indian domestic IT is just about, it has just about begun. And hence in the long term, every sector, whether it is BFSI, whether it is consumer, whether it is enterprises or even government to that extent, is, I think IT long term is has a still lot of headroom to growth. For example, some very large programs in the government space, we have started seeing them now. So entire Aadhaar, UIDAI Aadhaar, is first of many that should happen in India. Or then use of IT for online citizen services, where every citizen interacts for various purposes with government machinery, whether it's for filing taxes, for getting land records, for birth record registration, and so on and so forth. I think IT can simplify service delivery to citizens in a big way. And hence, I think increasingly we will see it penetrating that's even governance sphere in a big way. Healthcare and education, which are two large social sectors where, and each of them are fairly big in India, each of them are $50 billion kind of sectors. Penetration of IT in delivery of those services is still very low. And in bridging a education divide in the country and haves and have not divide, again, IT can play a big role in taking those services to remote parts of the country, whether it's quality education or whether it's quality healthcare delivery. You're not going to get good teachers and good doctors to be available in every part of the country. Everybody wants a cushy life in a metro. With this urbanization phenomenon, how do you at the same time make these services available in every other part of the country? Again, IT will have a huge role to play. And there I would say, right now we are just scratching the surface in terms of telemedicine or e-learning wave that's coming into the country. So long term, I see a lot of headroom. I think double digit growth year after year for many years to come is there in India. Even in devices, when we go to the consumer side, our device penetration, that is computing device per 100, is under 15. Just to give you an example, China is close to 60, Brazil is over 80, and pretty much all of developed market is over 100. That means per citizen, there is one device out there, whereas in India, it's only 50. So, 1.5. So there is a lot of headroom, even in devices market, in the long run. Now that's the long term, mid-term to long-term view. Short-term, domestic IT industry is going through severe headwinds. For 2-3 reasons. Number one, let's say, is on the supply side, where you source pretty much everything as import. 90% or 93% of IT products that are sold are imported. And value addition of the domestic industry is very, very small in terms of actual manufacturing value addition. Now, when you have such a high import dependence, and in 2 years, exchange rate goes up by almost 35%, from 45 to now 64 today, it creates a lot of turbulence in the ecosystem. Many suppliers get compressed because they have rupee commitments to their customers, but their costs go up. So there is a short-term turmoil that creates. Or when you go to consumer side where you don't have fixed price in rupee and you pass on price increase to the consumer, it's a jerky price increase that happens. And hence, you know, when you increase prices with 8%, 10% suddenly, consumer stops buying, thinking that one day the price will again, you know, get rolled back. We're used to this rollback. And rollback is difficult when you are 93% of what you are supplying is imported and that cost has gone up. So short term, there is a supply side shock that the IT industry has received in terms of the supply side cost going up with exchange rate phenomenon. Simultaneously, there is a second shock that the domestic IT industry has received is the spend has gone down exactly at the same time. Because of the sentiment in the economy, capital spend has gone down. In fact, whether it's enterprises or whether it's government, capital formation has dropped by 30-35% in the country. And we are seeing result of that in different capital goods sectors, infrastructure, capital goods, consumer durables, which is also in a way discretionary long-term spend in nature. Each of these sectors are seeing year-on-year decline in last 2 years or so. So there is a demand compression that has happened, and while there is a demand compression, there is a supply side cost shock that has been given to the domestic IT industry. So right now it's going through a very turbulent time, but that sometimes can cloud our view of the industry when you look at it from a long-term headroom for growth. So short-term industry is going through pain, whether it's a devices industry, whether it's IT projects industry, or whether it's a technology-enabled learning industry, you know, where likes of Educomp and NIIT, Evron's play. Sector by sector, you see they are reeling under pain, red all over their balance sheets. Many of them are close to shutting shop, but that does not mean that the long-term potential is not there. So hence, to an answer like what's your view of Indian IT, domestic IT industry, it's a very two dichotomous answer. Midterm to long-term, headroom is there. Would we need it in the country? Of course we would need it. In the short term, are we going through a big turmoil in this space? We are going through a big turmoil.
What do you think are the challenges or the opportunities present in the domestic IT industry?
Sure. Our SMB as a space is still under-penetrated by IT. And now with advent of cloud computing and acceptance of software as a service, I think many applications and capabilities that large enterprises could have in-house with their own IT department are increasingly becoming available to that entire SMB space. And in India, SMB is a very, very large market, both in terms of its value addition or in terms of employment. Applications such as small ERPs, let's say CRM, HR management application, even their disaster recovery, business continuity, through infrastructure as a service is all now available with cloud computing increasingly becoming an acceptable framework in the country. So cloud computing and what it does for SMB is one very large opportunity. Second trend is I would say the entire advent of mobility as a space. Increasingly mobile handheld device, whether it's a high-end smartphone or it's a tablet, is increasingly now becoming the first computing device even for students and for young working executive. Now, while that creates a new opportunity of growth, it also creates an, on an enterprise side, newer sets of requirements. So what can you do with that device in field force automation? How would you handle security related aspects? Again, that creates opportunities for IT companies. So entire mobility as a space is creating opportunities both at a device side as well as enterprise services side. And we are seeing increasingly opportunities for field force automation, for taking ERP applications on mobile handheld devices, kind of requirements emerge. Security mobile device management requirements emerge in IT departments of enterprises. So that's a second big opportunity, I think, that's emerging in the domestic IT. Third opportunity that's emerging is in the entire business analytics space, and that is largely today in the large enterprises. So while cloud is SMB and large enterprises, mobility is consumers and large enterprises. business analytics is largely today in mature large enterprises who finish their wave of ERP implementations and are now trying to get extract that last juice out of their ERP investment, and where you are dealing with whole lot of consumers, whole lot of data, so utility companies, retail companies, where your number of transactions are many, and you can actually analyze that data to look for trends. Now companies have, insurance companies, banking companies, they've started looking at what to do with all this data. And I would say early pilots of this have begun. So in terms of dollars, it's still small, but in terms of potential that it has for the country, it's large. So all the three big buzzwords that you hear in global IT, you know, cloud, mobility, and big data, all of them have started now taking roots in country in different shape and form. Cloud largely for SMB, and big data largely for big organizations. So that's as far as I would say opportunities in terms of technology trends. Then there are some verticals where there is a lot of opportunity, and those are, I would say, the new emerging verticals in the country. So financial inclusion space, where now taking banking to the unbanked, is creating a big wave of technology implementation, where you are taking the power of banking infrastructure to that 60 crore of our population that does not have banking infrastructure available. Their only way you can get them in the banking fold is through technology. Opening a branch costs almost 40-50 rupees per transaction in a rural area. Even if you set up an ATM there, it will cost 10 to 12 rupees per transaction. But you take power of banking through mobile banking or internet banking or those handheld based business correspondent network, it will cost a fraction of a rupee. So if you want to get that 60 crore unbanked into the banking fold, only way it can be done is through a deeper penetration of technology for financial inclusion. That's one big space emerging. Healthcare and education, again, you know, I would say almost 50% of our schools do not have quality teachers. How do you get good quality education? You can create, you know, brick and mortar schools where will you get good teachers from? Again, a huge opportunity emerging there. So education, healthcare, BFSI in its next wave of expansion, SMB, so all of those are verticals where there is a growth. And cloud, mobility, big data, definitely we are seeing those technology trends also take roots in the country. And the next one that I would talk about, where also there will be an opportunity, is the wave of IT outsourcing or managed services happened only at the, let's say, top of the pyramid. So it's the Airtels of the world outsource their IT to, let's say, Airtel did it to IBM. But those benefits and challenges that enterprises face in managing the technology investments that they've made are all pervasive. Even a 1,000 crore company has a challenge of keeping pace with the IT technology, retaining IT talent, you know, keeping pace, deciding what investment is meaningful, what investment is not meaningful. It's difficult for all enterprises to handle this. And now it's the wave of this next rung of enterprises and organizations which are looking at IT outsourcing to somebody, hopefully like us, you know, so the IT service companies who can then step in and provide IT as a managed service. So all the, let's say, marquee names, which are the bellwether names, did it in first wave. Now the next wave has begun, and that's a very large base of the middle and the base of the pyramid, where IT as a managed service is a next wave that we expect will happen in the country.
So where are you looking for help in achieving your objectives?
I will look at it from help from 2-3 different sections. You know, as a industry participant, help from every quarter is welcome. But I'll talk about, let's say, two big quarters. One is, let's take government. A policy framework which creates a stable exchange rate regime, stable interest rate regime, would certainly be a big help. Certain quicker decision making on many projects has its impact even on IT. So when a project gets stalled, 2% of that project spend is on IT, that 2% spend also gets stalled. So when today we hear a lot about many projects, lakhs of crores of projects stalled, tens of thousands of crores of IT spend on there has also got stalled. So quicker decision making on projects is another. Third, which is very IT specific, is many of the procurement policies when it comes to IT itself of government probably may need to be re-looked into, because technology, pace of change of technology is now much more, much faster than the pace of decision making that one is seeing in the public sector. To give you an example, if some state or some department wants to buy tablets, some simple example, for either their workers or to give to somebody like students. If you are going to run a process of 6 months or 1 year to evaluate and buy, in 1 year that tablet becomes obsolete. You know, in this technology changes every 3 months, and you will be one or two generations older if you are going to take 9 months and 12 months to decide. So I think the procurement process needs to now get synchronized with the current pace of technology. And because it's not synchronized, many large procurement programs of government are actually not becoming successful. Either the end result is not successful in terms of its outcome, or the procurement itself doesn't go through because somewhere then it hits a roadblock. Even let's say the one is the decision making for procurement. Second is, let's say, decision making for inspection and clearance. Now in the olden days, when you had a computer which was equal to size of this room, you needed a procurement process of inspection, tests, etc. When the power of that is, that machine is today available in a quick turn it on and it's ready to use kind of a machine and a handheld, you don't need that kind of inspection process. And but if our inspection process is still the same, we are building inefficiency and cost into that entire system, and there is a big need to relook into some of that. That's a second. Third, if the procurement commercially is going to look for uniform taxes and duties, firm price in rupee, and single biggest cause for change of this is government itself, the buyer himself, that customs duty will go up, excise duty will undergo a change. To expect the supplier to be constrained with fixed price is unfair, and because of that, actually a lot of players in IT industry are actually suffering, and many qualified players are actually staying away from supplying to this section of the market. That, and then government spending, which can act as a big enabler of growth, because in a time of a downturn, country after country has seen that government actually steps in, and it's the government spending that acts as a growth booster, because others take time to start spending. You need somebody to start spending to rev up the economy, and government spending can help. Right now it is not helping. It's exactly acting as the reverse, because many are saying, hey, government spending stay away. You know, first decisions are not happening, and those which are happening are commercially unviable. Because if somebody is going to decide with onerous terms, not pay on time, have fixed price commitments where taxes and duties from the buyer himself are going to undergo a change, people will shy away. So government spending actually, and government is a big spender on IT. Out of that $25 to $30 billion, somewhere between $7 or $8 billion gets spent by government. So it's a very large spender on IT, but that spending power is not getting used to rev up the IT industry. Rather, it's acting in the reverse. So what help one needs? One is looking for quicker decision making and a review of procurement policies when it comes to IT, procurement inspection policies when it comes to IT, because the pace of technology has changed over the last few years. So that's one section, and there can be again help offered by consulting companies like Deloitte to be as this bridge between the industry, global best practices, what's happening, and the government, to figure out what should those right policies and frameworks be. And there's a big need to come up with such revised policies and frameworks, and somebody who's neutral can act as that consultant and advisor. So there is a, now I'm switching topic, friends, from government, where consulting companies can help. they can play a role of trying to come up with these newer frameworks and policies on the government procurement side. Also, now moving from government to enterprises, many requirements are moving to more of a business transformation kind of requirements as to what can I do with cloud and mobility as technology to drive my business performance. What benefits can I seek to my business by outsourcing my IT? So there is a business transformation consulting which is required, and which is a business consulting angle which normally leads any IT consulting and IT implementation. And there is a big emerging need of this business consulting right now for business transformation requirements in terms of whether it's big data, whether it's mobility, whether it's cloud, whether it's this managed services, outcome-based managed services outsourcing. Somebody who can step in and analyze the customer's business and business processes and see what technology needs to be stitched together. And I think that's a big void where if somebody steps in and, you know, bridges that void, more and more of that spend will happen, which will benefit the customer community as they will get the benefits out of such a spend and also help the IT. So this business consulting as a front end to IT consulting, and overall policy and framework related consulting to the customer called government sector are, I would say, the two big helps that one is looking for right now.
So what are your views on the depreciating rupee? Since it's recently, we've just heard today itself, it's hit 6.64.44.
Right.
So what do you think, where is the, how is that impacting the IT industry, and your general view as on the rupee and how it can
so- As I said, almost 60% of the domestic IT industry is supplies, whether it's PCs, tablets, servers, storage devices, networks, you know, all of that, software, it's all supply that you do, for which you import stuff. So any sharp increase is very, very bad, both for the customer and for the supplier. And I would say domestic IT industry, which is in the supply side of the industry, is right now, all of them are bleeding. And bleeding because they are unable to absorb these sudden shocks. If it's a gradual secular decline in line with difference in the interest rates or different in inflation, that you can predict that, you know, 6% year on year rupee will depreciate because that's a relative difference between the interest rates of different economies, then it is something that one can predict, factor, hedge, and so on. But the way currently it's happening, that it suddenly goes up, suddenly goes down, that's what is right now pretty much, I would say, causing havoc in the IT hardware part of the industry. IT services, which is 40%, $10 billion of the market, that is quite immune. And in fact, when there is more pain to the customer community, they start looking at every area for cost optimization with a magnifying glass, and IT outsourcing is one such cost optimization possible. Hence, that part of the industry gets a lift. So IT services is hence doing well, even the domestic IT services is doing well. Is the IT hardware and IT software supply has gone through quite ahead for the last 18 months or so. So would I want this sudden volatility to end in the rupee? Absolutely. I think that's really causing a lot of turmoil in the domestic IT industry.
Thank you, sir, for taking our time, and we really appreciate your views.
Sure.